listening to OffPlanet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
Everybody, welcome back to another edition of Off Planet TV. It's just me this week. Randy was unable to make it, so I'll be running it my first chance of taking it by myself. So here we go. All right, we have a special guest with us today, and let's see. My guest is a nonfiction author that writes about esoteric history. Her most well-known books include Clock Shavings, The Merovingian Mythos, Solomon's Treasure, and Money Grows on the Tree of Knowledge. Her latest is Baphomet, The Temple Mystery Unveiled, co-written with Alexander Rivera of TheEyeOnEye.com. Before writing books, she made a name for herself as the editor and publisher of a highly unique magazine entitled Dagobert's Revenge, which was published from 1996 to 2003. She has appeared on several radio shows, television shows, and film documentaries. Most notably, she has been interviewed on National Geographic's Is It Real? Da Vinci's Code, Jesse Ventura's Conspiracy Theory, and the documentary film Bloodline. She has appeared repeatedly on Coast to Coast AM and Ground Zero with Clyde Lewis, which she was the executive producer of for a period of time from 2014 to 2015, as well as on many other programs. She's here to discuss her recent articles and work on Saturn, David Bowie, Prince, and a variety of other topics. Tracy Twyman, welcome to Off Planet TV.
Thank you very much for having me. It's nice to be here.
Absolutely. Okay, so why don't you just tell us a little bit about yourself, how you got into writing about esoteric topics, and then a little bit of how you got into doing seances, which will be the first topic we get into tonight.
Sure. Well, writing about esoteric topics, I think, started really when I was about 15 or 16 years old. I was going to a community college there, and I was opinion page editor of the newspaper. So one of my things that I did was every week I would do what they called an opinion column, but I really just... it was like a well-researched essay that, would go on for a couple pages. And it was usually about what people might consider conspiracy theories. But, you know, I don't know. It was always full of facts. So,
right. Funny how that works, huh?
And, so I got interested in that kind of stuff. And that, so I sort of esoteric or behind-the-scenes politics, I guess. And then that quickly led to someone telling me about, the Masonic conspiracy theory. I thought that was fascinating. I was already kind of interested in the occult because I had read some Lovecraft stuff. I had the Necronomicon at home, and, I just thought it was fascinating, the idea that there was an occult secret society that was influencing politics and had historically for hundreds of years. So I got into that. Shortly led to me reading a series of books by Richard Bagent and Michael Bagent, Richard Lai. It was Holy Blood, Holy Grail, and Messianic Legacy. Those things really blew me away. By this time, I was about 18 years old, and I'd taken some college courses in history, like the history of Western civilization, and I thought those books really put it all together for me. In terms of patterns I had seen that hadn't been explained in the history books, connections between things that I could see were there, but I couldn't tell what it was. And I thought that book, which what it was about, is about not only the idea of a Masonic conspiracy, but in particular Masonic groups that had their allegiance to a bloodline that was allegedly from Mary Magdalene and Jesus. That's what they had speculated. And I just thought, again, that filled in a lot of the blanks. Like, of course, there's a reason why people think that that royal families are special. I had never understood why, though, and I thought that, that really explained it. Oh, there's, you know, there's something holy about them. And then I started to wonder, well, you know, surely it didn't just start with Jesus and Mary Magdalene. There have been royal families before then. You know, that, those books had speculated that there was also the specialness of this bloodline comes from their descendants from King David of Israel. Right. So anyway, I thought this is all fascinating. I ended up putting out a magazine called Dagobert's Revenge. It was, I lived in Portland at the time. This is, I still live in Portland now, but I've moved to different places. At any rate, I was going to college, like I said, in Portland, and this is like 1996, right? So there was still this thing going on that we called the zine scene, right. And it all faded away a few years later, but it was cool, you know, to self-publish magazines on a variety of obscure topics.
Yeah,
and distribute them yourselves, and there were stores in Portland that would sell these things. So I thought it'd be cool for me to do that. And actually, what I wanted to do was, I wanted to put out a magazine that seemed like as though it had been published by this secret society I had read about called the Priory of Zion.
Okay,
which is the secret society I was describing that's sort of affiliated with this royal bloodline.
Yeah,
and they're kind of, and the books that I had read implied that. They were like working behind the scenes to try to take over the Vatican and to try to put members of this bloodline in positions of power in politics. They implied that they basically wanted to take over the European Union and, you know, bring back the throne of France and all of these other countries that no longer have their monarchy. So anyway, I wanted to put out a magazine that looked like it was published by this organization. And it was just full of cryptic stuff that only people who had read those Holy Blood, Holy Grail books would get. It was sort of an art project, really. But after starting that, it evolved. I ended up doing some more issues. At first, it was just this one issue. And then, like, a couple years later, I brought it back. And that time, it was, like, real in-depth articles about these subjects.
Yeah.
And but still with the sort of mysterious symbolism here and there in the magazine to make people think it might be from a secret society.
Yeah.
And then I ended up getting together with some friends. We decided we would actually create such a secret society. And it wasn't the Priory of Zion. We call it Ordo Lapsus Excellus. So that was, what that comes from is, there's this story, Wolfram von Eschenbach wrote this, grail romance, about the grail as a stone, and he called it the stone that came from heaven, and he had some Latin words for that. It was kind of corrupt Latin, but anyway, that's what he called it, is Lapsus Excellus, and so we just thought we'd take that as our name. That's how I ended up doing, I would say, not just writing about conspiracy theories, but writing really sort of in-depth and esoteric material about the mysteries of the Western occult tradition. It grew from just talking about Freemasons and Priory of Zion into, you know, getting into some really in-depth stuff. And, I ended up folding that magazine, you know, when print magazine thing just wasn't viable anymore.
Yeah.
But I ended up writing books, and that's what I've been doing ever since. So that's how I got started. The Ouija board thing that you asked about, that was all part of the process too, because, I was doing all this research into these topics, and we got the idea. I was, working with several other people. One of them was a guy who ended up being my husband. I'm not married to him anymore, but, so he and I had this idea once that we should, call up Jean Cocteau, who's this dead French artist who, the Holy Blood, Holy Grail book said that he had probably been a grandmaster of this organization, Priory of Zion.
Okay.
And he had all these paintings, poems, films that he had written and directed. And, you know, I thought, well, let's talk to him on the Ouija board if we can to see if maybe he can explain some of the symbolism in his art and if it has something to, you know, if it connects to this grail mystery that we're researching. And, all the other topics we were researching. So that's how the idea came up. And I can't really tell you because I hadn't really done any sort of, you know, ritual magic or anything like that much. I don't know why I thought that it would work, but I don't know. My husband and I, or he wasn't, we weren't even married at the time, but he and I just, we went into it with total suspension of disbelief. Like we had no reason to believe or disbelieve that it would work. We didn't even think about it. I don't know. We just did it. And you know what? First thing, it worked. It worked really great. Yeah. And we ended up practicing, you know, doing it a lot more. And, you know, we just got really much, much better at it. And other entities, pardon me, other entities that we contacted, it turned out, had a lot more information to give us even than Jean Cocteau, because you don't have to just talk to dead people. There's demons and spirits and gods and all sorts of things out there that'll talk to you.
Yeah. So, okay. So that was, so a couple of things I wanted to say there. Yeah. I was wondering if Ouija boards had been something you had played with when you were a child. Like I never did, you know what I mean? And it actually is one of those things that didn't really occur to me much in my life. I was very busy. I was a gymnast. I just didn't do stuff like that. I knew people who did. I guess maybe I don't want to say I'm scared of doing stuff like that, but it just was one of those things that was like, I don't know if I'm going to screw with that stuff, but I have to admit, I know a little bit more about it as I've gotten into studying conspiracies and, you know, making the leap if you're actually really doing the work of researching these things to esoteric knowledge. You know, these kind of topics have come up. And so it's interesting, and I agree with you. One of the things I like about your work is how, from the very beginning, everything I've looked at of yours always ties anything conspiratorial back to something that is of esoteric knowledge or occult history. And I think that's really important, because what happened for me is I started looking into some, I've always been the person that knows that there's what you think is going on and what's really going on, and they're not usually the same thing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that kind of got into some conspiratorial stuff, looking at things. But what started happening for me is as I started having inner experiences with dancing and creativity and music and things that I'm into, I started seeing symbolism of esoteric and occult stuff that I didn't have knowledge. So I was seeing it and then having to go, what am I looking at here? And it turned out that these things that were being shown to me when I'm in, you know, a meditative space with dance or whatever, were the signs that that was where I needed to look next in my research of things I wanted to, you know, have further information about. So it's interesting, you know, so there is that definite tie, and I think people who don't look at that are really missing almost the whole picture.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I appreciate that about your work. You know, it was interesting. I remember hearing you say that, I think I heard you say or read somewhere that when you first did it, you had no idea you were opening the portals to hell. Is this scary to you? Like, I that's what I was really waiting to ask you. Is this scary? Does it make you nervous? Like, what's the...
I should probably be scared, but I haven't been. Like I said, it seemed so natural to me when we started. Yeah. And then it has progressed in its own natural way so that, I mean, really scary things have happened, you know. They've talked to me about hell. They've told me I'm going to hell. They persuaded me to put a curse on one of my friends to try to kill him. He had sort of stabbed me in the back. And I was, you know, after talking to, we were talking to Baphomet and to Satan and Lucifer and all these guys, you know, my comfort level with talking about, I guess, scary and dark subjects grew a lot over time, so that things that probably should have bothered me didn't. But, you know, in the end, none of the worst case scenarios have happened yet, I don't think. I really don't feel like I've become demonically possessed ever.
No,
I've never seen the, you know, planchette fly off, although it has almost kind of levitated off the Ouija board at times. And I don't know, just nothing really scary has happened yet. So I just feel like I'm just talking to these things, you know?
Yeah, it's interesting. Go ahead.
No, but I guess to answer your question fully, there have been times frequently where I felt like maybe this is having subtle negative effects on my life. Like, I'll have bad luck and I'll think, well, I wonder if this is somehow related, but I can't really pin it down. I don't know.
Yeah, so it's interesting because you don't strike me at your energy. You have a palpable energy field, and you don't come off as a dark or scary person. You come off as a curious, inquisitive person who wants to know about stuff. And I consider myself to be like that as well. But I've had the same experience. You know, I think I'm a dancer. I got into this thing not intentionally, where I was basically, I guess, for lack of a better way of explaining it, channeling kind of information while I was dancing. And it wasn't something I was doing intentionally. And, you know, I wasn't sure what it was at first. And over time, I have asked myself those same questions, you know, about what exactly, because, you know, it was really like this, I started having this sort of mental relationship and give and take and back and forth with something that was sort of giving me information, not really answering questions. When I ask questions, I only ever get one answer, and the answer is always the same. You know what I mean? But it was giving, so basically when I dance, I get some sort of visions, and the answer I get is that this is the sacred geometry of space, time, and sound. So I'll get all sorts of information about the universe, about the world. I'll see all sorts of crazy, interesting things, but a lot of them make sense. I see lots of like symbolism of things of ancient Egypt, of how ancient energy systems worked, I see all sorts of stuff. But when I ask a particular question, I only ever get, this is the sacred geometry of space, time, and sound. And which is perfect on one level for a dancer. You know what I mean? That makes a lot of sense. But and another, what does that mean? You know, I've researched, what does that mean? I've been sitting with that for a number of years, and I've developed some ideas about it. But when you research, you can find information about sacred geometry. You can find information about time and sound, space and sound, all that kind of stuff. But no one has put them together like that. And, you know, so it's one of those things that I've been kind of trying to figure out for a period of time. And I think that's one of the things that interested me about your work is I'm sort of viewing it, and it was viewing it through a geometric form, but it's become clear to me that some of these entities, spirits, demonics are geometric. They're geometric. That's how they sort of birth themselves into things. And so I just, you know, I don't know how to explain it. Almost like it opens a gate for things to come through. I'm not clear on any of this. I'm not sure of it, but as I sort of understood that, I started to ask myself the same questions about, have I let things into my body and into my mind through this process that I was doing that have a negative effect, or that have, I don't feel like I'm possessed, but the same question, you know, has something possessed me? So that's interesting. Just out of curiosity, since we're on it, have you, in any of the information you've ever gotten from beings that you contact, has anyone ever passed information about sacred geometry?
Well, there'll be references to shapes as sometimes, I mean, we have symbols on our board. We have our own board that we've designed that was actually dictated to my husband by Baphomet. Brian, I should just call him Brian so there's no confusion. I'm married to a different guy now, and Brian is deceased. So, but at any rate, the board has symbols on it, right? So as far as geometric symbols, there's really only two. There's a pentagram and there's a hexagram.
Yeah.
And they've used that to speak. In particular, the seance that you wanted to ask about with Prince that we did recently, he talked a lot about Saturn. Mm-hmm. And when he first introduced the topic, he kept going to the hexagram on our board. Yeah. And you know, that was his way of kind of pointing the way to what he really wanted to talk about. So, I think that, you know, if I asked about sacred geometry more, I probably would get answers, but I haven't really focused on that too much.
I noticed when so we'll get into this now talking about Prince and the seance that you did. But yes, I did notice that was part of the reason why I wanted to ask you that after, you know, about the hexagram. Okay. Mm-hmm. Tell everybody what you did. Randy sent me a link to a posting you'd made, and I watched the entire video of you and your friend. I think her name was Ashley doing this dance, and I have to say it was fascinating. And I kind of wished I was there with you guys asking questions. It was really interesting. I liked your whatever process you've developed. Like, it made sense to me. Like, you know, there's a rhythm to it, and what was coming through, even the way that Prince was behaving, seemed like, didn't surprise me. You know what I mean? Like, it seemed very true to who he was. So tell us what you were doing, why you were doing it, and what you found, what Prince had to say.
We were just doing it because, you know, I've decided that I want to produce more content for the public with my Ouija board, because the way you're reacting is the way a lot of people react. They really enjoy stuff that we do, and I feel like I want to share it. So I asked one of my friends to come over, Ashley, and, you know, we set up the camera, and we just decided to do Prince because he had died recently, and we were both big fans.
Yeah,
I had talked about Prince's death on the radio a couple weeks earlier, so it just seemed appropriate. You know, like I told you, you know, not only do you not are you not limited to dead people on the Ouija board, but mostly I've talked to other kinds of entities. Yeah. So I haven't spent a lot of time talking to dead people, but I decided to do Prince, and it actually worked out pretty well. Although, you know, I can't even say even now that I'm sure it was him. And one of the reasons why I say that is because I would have expected him to use the number 4 instead of spelling it out and things like that. I didn't see any of that, you know, that type of writing that he would usually use. I didn't see any of that expressed. But who knows? Maybe he's, you know, sort of beyond that at this point. Maybe he's over it. He doesn't do that anymore. I don't know.
Right.
so, but he did...
He was always much more a fan of symbols than words. So yes, that is, yeah.
but whatever the spirit was, it ended up getting into some topics that I thought were really interesting, giving me a different way of looking at things. So I'm trying to remember how it all got started, but two things he talked about. He talked about Saturn. I guess I can't remember how the conversation progressed. It sort of bounced all over the place. So I'll try to summarize it then instead of telling it as a narrative.
Okay.
There was this aspect about Saturn where he wanted to tell us, okay, actually, I think I do remember now how it went a little bit. Okay.
Okay.
Because we have to back up to, first we were asking about his death, right? And he didn't really have a lot to share about that.
Did you have a preconceived idea about his death? Did you have some story you had put together in your head about what you thought had happened or?
No, not at all. I thought it could go either way. I mean, you know, his death seemed odd, but not entirely, you know, the explanation we were given seems reasonable. Right. So I just, you know, I thought we'll ask him and see what he has to say. He gave us two different answers in the course of that. So originally he said he was not murdered. Later he kind of indicated that he was. But he didn't really seem to want to focus on it. So, and he had so many other interesting things to say that we just, with what he wanted to say.
So, proceed.
I think this ended up, he ended up telling us about this group called the Settlers.
Mm-hmm.
And what he explained that was, is he said it was this group that controls the music and television industry, and they're the Settlers because they have everyone, all these stars and celebrities, they all these guys owe them money. And again, I don't know if I believe this or not, but this is just the story he told us. He said that the stars owe the Settlers money, and that's why they're called the Settlers, because they settle debts. You know, when they don't get paid back, they go and threaten people and perhaps even kill them.
Yes.
In retribution. And who are these people? He said they are agents of the Saudi royal family. So I wasn't expecting that either. That came out of nowhere. We had been asking him, what was your purpose for being born on Earth, you know? And, pardon me, he said, that he had been sent here to put out a radio transmission. Those were his words. And we said, what about, he says, the Quran. And we're like, what? That doesn't make any sense. And he says, he starts talking about, he says, sin, real sin is hard. Like it's hard to actually commit a real sin.
Yeah.
And he also said it further, like, also, when you do a real sin, it's hard on you. Like implied that there's great spiritual baggage that comes from committing a real sin. And then what is the real sin? He said, the real sin is murder.
Yeah.
And it all sort of, I can't remember exactly how the conversation went, but it was basically he was connecting all these things. So he starts talking, he was talking about murderers inspired by the Quran. Which, you know, I mean, we've seen lots of that in, you know, over the course of several decades. But this was, when we had this conversation, this was, I think, within 24 hours of the Orlando massacre that happened like the next day. So, and then as we've seen, there's just been a nonstop string of terrorist attacks in the West.
Right.
From ISIS mostly, ever since then. So it's like that. this conversation we had with Prince happened right as this wave of real sin, murder committed by people inspired by the Quran, as soon as it started. So that's interesting.
Isn't that, well, Prince has always been the person talking about something before everybody else is talking about it. He was talking about musical copyright issues when nobody knew what the hell he was talking about, you know? So that was one of the many things in this process that seemed true to who Prince actually was. There were some that didn't, like you said, but this is one of the things that he absolutely did. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And then as regarding the settlers, we asked him, I guess, why people get in debt. He said it had something to do with TV rating, TV and radio ratings. So yeah. I mean, I don't know what that means. Like, if you don't get the ratings, then you owe them money or something.
Or if they get you the good ratings, do you owe them money? Like, which one is it?
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. So then he made this sort of spontaneous statement. He said, REM is next, next to sell out.
Yeah.
And so that, we thought that was, I thought that for, that's when I started suspecting this isn't really Prince. This is probably a demon of some sort reading my mind and then giving me what I want to hear, because I had just a couple of 3 months ago written a long article about symbolism I saw in REM lyrics and in videos.
Huh. I wasn't aware of that. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
Oh, it's about my theory that Michael Stipe has believed in the flat earth theory, you know, long before it was popular.
Right.
And when you look at his songs and videos and even movies that have been made that have REM on the soundtrack, you can see evidence of this. But that's kind of another topic. Although Prince, we asked him if the earth was flat and he said yes.
Yeah.
And then and we tried to get an explanation of the cosmology, and it's still kind of
You got some stuff. I mean it was interesting the way you did it. Didn't he say that space was fake?
He said space is fake. He said we're inside of an enclosure and outside of, you know, and the enclosure includes the zodiac.
Yeah.
Right. So it goes all the way up to the stars. And then outside of the enclosure is death.
Yeah.
So there's nothing beyond that, which is exactly what the Gnostics viewed the universe as being, that we're all inside these concentric spheres, really.
Yeah.
Each sphere is a heaven. Each heaven is controlled by one of the archons, which corresponds with a planet.
Yeah.
So, and Earth is in the middle.
Yep.
So that was interesting that he confirmed that. And actually, this stuff about the Gnostic cosmology, I became a lot more clear about it after the seance. So I didn't really know as much as I know now before the seance.
We can finish the seance, and then you wrote another post about that afterwards, and we can get into that after we're done talking about seance. So, yeah.
Sure, yeah. So so then he told us about, so all this dovetails somehow into telling us about Saturn. I think, because we asked who's really bankrolling all of this, and where does the money come from? And he said it comes from the test. What's the test? Okay. Long story short, he explains that it is, he explains essentially that we're living in a fake reality, mm-hmm. that the reality is being controlled somehow from Saturn.
Right.
And basically it sounded like he was describing an AI computer system on Saturn that is somehow putting out a signal that is, hypnotizing us, keeping us in a fake reality of some sort.
Yeah.
I don't know what that means exactly, but what's interesting is that, let's see, I don't know, maybe a couple weeks after this seance happened, a video popped up in my YouTube feed, and it was David Icke talking about Saturn and how he thinks that Saturn is putting out radio waves that are creating a fake reality for us. And apparently, I've learned since that David Icke has talked about this before. I didn't know that at the time, so I just thought it was an amazing coincidence, but it turns out David Icke has talked about this before. And what's interesting, too, is that Prince has a history with David Icke.
Yeah.
He actually invited David Icke to one of his concerts and had a conversation with him backstage and kind of told him that, you know, he's right about a lot of things, and the implication was he's kind of right about his theory of, you know, the reptilians controlling the world. And really what I think he meant by that is that we're living in a fake reality, which he's indicated. Yeah, he talked about at one point, he said that that when he joined the Jehovah's Witnesses and had that conversion experience, that was like waking up in the Matrix, like Neo. Yeah. So we don't know exactly what Prince believed about all this, but it seems like, you know, one way or another, he believed we were living in a fake reality.
Yeah.
And then his mentor, David Icke, is coming out and saying Saturn is the one controlling us.
Yeah. So I found all of this fascinating because a lot of those similar things have been coming up for me in just my own personal journey recently and other people I've been talking to. So I've always felt like some very strong, I'm not even saying it's positive or negative connection to Saturn, but particularly when I'm dancing and doing these things, I get a lot of things that seem like information from Saturn. In fact, I tried to draw a little picture. Where did I put it? I tried to draw a little, I don't know where it went. I have this vision that I've been seeing a lot lately. And actually I saw it the same week that I read your article, and I see it on the back of my eyelids when I'm dancing, and I'm drawing it again right now because I can't, it's just a terrible drawing of it. But it's like the Masonic symbol, but a multidimensional Masonic symbol with Saturn in the middle and an eye up top, like an Egyptian, like the Eye of Ra or Eye of Horus kind of thing.
Okay.
I can't remember if it was before the article came out with Saturn as dreams, master of dreamscape reality. It was in the same week that I saw your stuff. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times what happens for me is I'll go into a party, I like techno music, I go to underground parties, and when I go into the room, I'll sort of get an impression, and then sort of all night I'll work with the impression and information comes with it and flesh it out, and it becomes this amazing collage of picture stuff in my head, you know, at the end of the night. But the first thing I got when I walked into the room that night was that, and it was a kind of a pinkish purple color. And I thought, well, that's really interesting because all this stuff had been coming up and I'm seeing the Masonic symbol, Saturn in the middle, eye on top. What does that mean? Hmm. And then you have the video, which I've heard David Icke talk about some of that stuff. There was also a video that came out this week. I don't know if you saw it, they were able to sort of recreate or see what it looks like to see a photon of light. And it looks exactly like the shape that David Icke was describing as the sound. It's the red cross of all of these secret societies, the same symbol sort of that he was talking about in that video. I'll link to the video. I should have pulled it up so I could have shown you. It looks exactly of light what he was talking about with sound. And one of the things that I've thought for a long time, because I have so much experience being in an environment that is totally bathing in sound and light, is that that's how they're controlling us, completely with sound and light. And when I'm looking at this stuff on Saturn and they're showing the hexagonal shape and the different cymatics on the top, that's certainly, to me, when thinking about all this stuff, it sounds a lot like the sacred geometry of space, time, and sound, right? Mm-hmm. If Saturn is controlling time and they're sending a radio transmission, right? And it's through what we think of as space. Well, there mm-hmm. we go. And so it was really interesting. I love the way you put all those different things into the same post. You had the seance, you had the thing with David Icke, you had the information about cymatics, you had information about David Bowie and Philip K. Dick and all of these things that were just really things that have been swirling in my mind and interrelated. Mm-hmm. And is that stuff you thought about before? Do you think of I'm sure you've gotten a lot of information about Saturn in your adventures on the other side.
I can see we know that, yes, Saturn is putting out radio waves. Probably all the planets and stars are putting out radio waves.
Yeah.
But on Saturn, it's manifesting in the shape of this hexagon at the top. So anyway, yeah, cymatics is, you know, what is that? It's like the science of how sound moves air so as to move the molecules of things, and therefore it changes.
It shapes, yeah.
It makes little geometric shapes out of things sometimes. So I can see how, in a similar way, something like that could be happening where these, you know, we call them planets, whatever they are putting out these radio waves, and it's creating geometry in our minds.
Yes.
That, you know, makes us think that we're seeing a world around us that is maybe entirely different than what the world is. So
that geometry in the mind may be the prism or the prism. What I'm seeing a lot of in my head looks a lot like really beautiful, colorful prism things that are like, you know, making different perspectives on what I'm looking at. It's almost like I'm stuck inside the prism. It's very colorful. I'm looking out and it's distorting what I'm seeing. So maybe what I'm actually seeing is the architecture of the artificial intelligence program that is being run from Saturn on us. Does that make sense?
It does. Yeah. So you're poking up out of the matrix for a while and kind of seeing how it works. Yeah. Regarding the symbolism of Saturn and how it matches up exactly with what we're talking about, Saturn is thought of as being sort of the master of illusions. This really goes back to, of course, the mythology of the wars between the Titans and the Olympian gods. The story is Saturn was, or Kronos to the Greeks, he's time, okay? He existed before creation. And the idea is that they tell the story of the golden age of Saturn, that he was the king of the world back when there was this, quote, golden age, and that everything was great because there was just one season, you know, it was always spring, basically.
Right.
Nobody had to work. They just would eat the fruit from the trees, and they were running around naked and happy and free. And there's a dark side to this, however, which is that the prosperity of this era was maintained through the preventing children from being born. Now, so in other words, what they're trying to symbolize there, I think, with this parable is a time in which there's time. Creation hasn't really come out of it yet, so there's not really time, space, or any matter. There's no space for things to move around in, and that's kind of how we perceive time, right? We perceive time because things move around in space. So what we're talking about here is a struggle between this pre-creation existence and the creation existence that wants to come out and be born and live.
Right.
Well, you can only keep the state of perfection that's being described in the golden age if you prevent time from happening, if you prevent the future from being born. And so the story is that King Saturn was afraid. There was a prophecy that he was going to be usurped by one of his sons. And so he would make his wife deliver their children to him as soon as they were born, and then he would swallow them. Mm. And the story is that they're still alive inside his stomach, just, you know, sitting there. And so again, this is a symbol of just holding it back, holding back something that wants to come out.
Yeah.
So anyway, the whole thing ended with Zeus was born, and his mother just couldn't bring herself to let this child be sacrificed too. So she substituted a stone instead. And I guess Zeus wasn't paying that much attention to the stone, and Zeus was born. And then he did, of course, the prophecy was fulfilled. He ended up, usurping his father. And then he became the king of the gods. The Olympus became the center of the god world. And, Saturn and all of the other monsters and demons, gods, whatever you want to call them, that the Titans that had fought on his side against the Olympians, they got sent down into the pit, you know, Tartarus. They got put in hell, in prison. But it's kind of like the kids were in his stomach, but they never died. Saturn is still there. He's still alive. But they describe him, for instance, Plutarch describes Saturn as being in a state of death-like dreaming sleep.
Yeah.
And that his dreams are affecting, the people in the world. So he's like running the show behind the scenes. Even though he's dreaming, he's subtly affecting everything in the world with his dreams.
Yeah.
And he even described there's this island that Saturn is on, and he goes into people's dreams and inspires them to come to his island. And then they come there and they're sort of apprentice to him, and they learn the mysteries of the universe from him. And there's even a set period of it that you're supposed to be a student for 13 years. Mm-hmm. And afterwards you can decide whether you want to stay or not. And the Plutarch says almost everyone decides to stay because it's this perfect, wonderful place. There's no work to do. You just get to learn and enjoy yourself. So anyway, these are the aspects of Saturn, right? He is the master of dreams and illusions. Yeah. He's also a teacher. And he was the first king of, you know, some kind of pre-creation world. But he's also symbolic of death because, of course, time is death. We all die eventually over the passage of time. And then there's this, you know, myth about him keeping his kingdom by feeding upon the youth. And, you know, I mean, I don't want to get into the whole thing, but I've written a couple of books about this topic, too.
Yeah.
This is really the sort of guiding principle behind the way society is structured now, in particular the monetary system. Everything is about creating, you know, prosperity now by taking from the future, taking from what our, you know, our kids will have, indebting them, taking their resources. And, you know, again, it's the sort of thing that can't last forever, and it will always have some sort of dramatic, horrible end.
Yeah, I mean, the whole time I was thinking that this sounds an awful lot like, I was thinking two things. It sounds an awful lot like the world we're living in to a certain extent, but also when you're describing the island and going there for knowledge, it sounds to me, to my experience, I'm having with this, that sounds like where I'm going in my head.
Yes, exactly. That's why I brought it up. Yeah.
Yes. And that, you know, and I would say that for a number of years, I was enamored with that and totally trapped in that to a certain extent. And it made functioning on the outside world really difficult because it was amazingly beautiful space in there. And just, you know, for the last year, I've been intentionally not going to that space at all. When I dance, I'll like check the picture out, but I don't play with it anymore. I look and see what's going on. I don't play with it. And it's amazing how much more effective I've been in my life since I stopped doing that, since I stopped sort of playing along and able to, you know, I had all these beautiful things as knowledge and ideas were coming to me, but I wasn't doing anything that was helpful to myself really, or to anyone else in my real life. And when I sort of decided to step away from that, even though at times I miss that terribly, you know, cause it's beautiful and it's wonderful and it's perfect and whatever it is, but it's all in my head to a certain extent. And it occurred to me that I was being controlled by something completely outside of myself in that space. So it's interesting that as long as we stay in that space, there is no making things better. There's just, you know, trying to suspend the now by stealing from the future. And, and then when I've gotten out of the space, I feel, you know, much more effective at trying to make a little change, whatever affects things, whatever way I can, to make it so that I'm not stealing from other people's lives and future. And not that I was stealing before, but you understand what I'm saying. So I think that was a great summary. And that was when I read the way you would put all that together, I was like, wow, man, that's exactly it. You know, so I love that. Okay. So that was excellent. What do you, one of the things I found the most interesting, again, I mentioned this, was how sort of weird and evasive Prince, as you were talking to Prince, was being during this thing. Do you find that often? In some ways, that's who Prince was. Just when you thought you understood who he was sort of something else, and then something else, and then go back to being a thing you thought he was before, and whatnot. So I thought that was really interesting. So that's interesting that you find that with others as well. Tell us a little bit, you also mentioned some things about David Bowie, in that article, in that initial article. Actually, no, let's, yeah. And about the idea of the radio transmission and how, okay, explain that a little bit, because I think that'll give people like a visual who aren't completely on board with what we're talking about here.
Okay, well, I mentioned David Bowie in an article that I wrote that was about this seance.
Yeah.
And that, just because, actually, we mentioned David Bowie in the seance just briefly, and here's why. I told you that Prince had said that his purpose on Earth was to put out a radio transmission, and then he went on to say that it had something to do with the Quran.
Yeah.
But that made me think immediately about the movie Man Who Fell to Earth,
right,
because that's what that's about. It's about an alien that comes to Earth, and then, and I think it was in the movie, it's, you know, an accident. He doesn't want to be there. I can't remember, but he doesn't want to be there. And so he's trying to get back home, but he has to, he's getting water for his home planet or something.
Yeah.
But anyway, part of it is that he has to become a billionaire. He creates this huge empire in like sound technology, and he buys a bunch of radio stations. And the purpose of all this is just to put out this radio transmission, because he knows that his wife on the other planet will eventually hear the transmission that he puts out. So what he does, he puts out a record, and it gets played on the radio, music, some kind of music. And of course, I'm sure in the story, it's like, you know, it's popular because it's a cool song, but really the whole purpose of putting it together is just so that his wife on the other planet could hear it. Now, that is connected to Philip K. Dick and his sort of autobiographical story called Valis.
Yeah.
That in that book, he had, let's see, it was fictional, but it was really about his own life, right?
Right.
But there was this fictional aspect in the story. He said that there was a character who was the leader of some kind of commune,
right,
in California.
Mm-hmm.
And people in the commune also had a band, and they put out a rock musical movie. And so the character in Philip K. Dick's book first sees the movie, and the movie reminds him of experiences he himself has had, where he's been having sort of hearing messages in his head.
Yeah.
In the movie, it all kind of corresponds to the messages he's been hearing in his head. What the movie is about is an alien trying to put out a radio transmission message to, some kind of some intelligence out on the, outside of our world. And I think it has to do with, there was some kind of coup with the government. And I'm trying to remember all the aspects of the story, but, again, it's the idea is just that, that you could be communicating to something besides just the people here if you put out a radio or television transmission or even on the internet. In fact, I think Prince told us, he gave us some instruction that we were supposed to post an image on the internet about Saturn.
Yeah.
And he even told us about this YouTube channel that we had to look at called Round Saturn's Eye. I still don't know what it all is supposed to mean, but it's an interesting way of looking at pop culture, music,
totally,
and TV. Like, what if a lot of it sometimes is a message to someone that you there's no way you would know who it was or what it means, right, because it's like some off-world intelligence.
Like, I mean, I see that theory, that what you just put out, as being entirely possibly a true scenario of what David Bowie was doing, of what Prince may have been doing, of what was happening to Philip K. Dick. You know what I mean? Well, I can certainly relate to that story that Philip K. Dick is talking about, channeling things and feeling like some kind of intelligence is communicating with you and whatnot. So that's, David,
well,
go ahead.
He thought that the reason why Philip K. Dick came up with all this stuff about the radio transmission, he was allegorizing the Gnostic story about, again, I'll have to go into this really long explanation. I'll try to make it short. But the idea is that in Gnosticism, the God that created this world is not a good guy necessarily. And
right,
there's a world beyond that called the Pleroma that is like real reality. And the story is that, and then there's a real God out there too.
Right.
And so the story is that the real God sort of lost a piece of himself inside this creation, when this creation is false and a prison and illusion. And so, and that piece of himself, it's kind of analogous to the idea of Jesus being Son of God, right? So, and in fact, some of the Gnostics were Christians, and that's how they viewed Jesus.
Yeah.
So, but not all of them called this figure Jesus. So another term for it is primal man. So the primal man is trapped inside this prison, Yeah, but his real father, his real, you know, world that he came from and the real reality is on the outside. So,
sounds reasonable always, to me.
He's all, so the story is about, oh, and once he gets down here, he sort of becomes amnesiac. He forgets where he is and where he came from. And then someone else has to come and remind him. Someone else has to come from the outside and remind him, wake him up. And then they liberate the world is how it's supposed to end the story. You know, they break all of us out of the prison. But anyway, so Philip K. Dick was thinking that now, in this world that we're in now, presently, we are receiving messages from the outside. And there are people inside here trying to talk to the outside. And, you know, he thought that, you know, sometimes when you look at TV or radio or movies or the newspaper, there will be messages in there that were meant for the people, for not even really people, but the spirits, I guess, on the outside. Yeah. So, yeah. Anyway, I didn't mean to interrupt what you were saying. I wanted to make that point.
No, that was perfect. I mean, I'm in sync with that. Not only do I like what you said, but that sounds perfectly reasonable to me. Like, that sounds like, I mean, all of these things you're describing that are supposedly, you know, myths and this kind of stuff, it sounds like a better explanation of what's going on than the official story we're being handed, right? So, I mean, yeah, especially with someone like David Bowie, when you look at his work, like, he was telling us who he was all along.
An alien?
I think he's been telling us a lot of things, but I think he is a lot of things. But, you know, like, one of the things that I thought when he died, especially with that last piece of music he put out and the strange video. And I mean, did you ever watch, we've told the story before on the show, but since I don't know if you're aware, did you watch the TV show Fringe?
You know what? I only got a couple episodes into that and I had to abandon it, but tell me.
It's a great show. I suggest you watch it because there's so much stuff there that's true and real. But there was a character in the first two seasons named David Robert Jones, which also happens to be David Bowie's real name, David Robert Jones.
Okay.
And David Robert Jones was a character who first was basically like jumping like through space and time. Like he broke out of a prison by basically, you know, jump rooming to somewhere else. Okay. Hmm. And over the course of the two seasons, he began jumping back and forth between, there was like another universe in Fringe, and he was jumping back and forth between the universes. And every time he would do this, that disassembly and reassembly of the molecular structure of his body would make it so his face was like almost like disintegrating. And by the end, he was holding his face together with the bandage that looked exactly like what David Bowie was wearing in that final video that he did. Okay.
Ooh.
Right. So when I put all that stuff together, I'm like, Fringe is great. There's so much stuff like that in Fringe. You should really watch it if you have a chance. But I was like, my thing was like, wait a second, David Bowie, they were telling us, and he's, you know, sort of confirming that he's a time traveler or able to move through space and time in ways that are different than we are. You know what I mean? And if you look at him, one of the things that was always interesting to me about David Bowie was, aside from the fact that he was strange, he looked strange, but always a different strange. Like sometimes he looked like an alien. Sometimes he almost looked like an animal. Sometimes he looked like he was kind of falling apart. And the same thing could be said for like Michael Jackson. Like some of these, right? And so as you also told me, I've long thought that he was doing some kind of space and time travel, and that, you know, moonwalking was something more than what we think it was. You know what I mean? Like he had part of his ability to move like that came from sort of a different feeling of space and time. But check out the Fringe thing. I don't know. I just, that whole thing with the bandages on the face and the name being the same and the moving, you know, what if that's something David Bowie was doing? What if he was traveling back and forth? What if he was sending messages and accusing, you know, it seems reasonable to me.
Well, here's another way of looking at that too. Okay. You remember in Man Who Fell to Earth that he had this skin that, yes, you know, he was wearing basically so that he would look like a human. And then I think it got accidentally stuck on him, or at least his eyes got stuck.
Yeah.
Photograph of him. I'm just barely remembering this, but okay, what you were describing about David Bowie, here's how I read that, or what I would, if I was going to take that seriously, where you're saying his body is falling apart and he's symbolizing it like a suit that needs to be replaced.
Yes.
Or like a snake that sheds its old skin and gets a new one. Well, this is this is something that alchemists supposedly are able to do. And also, you'll find a lot of horror stories about witches and warlocks that do things like this. So the idea is that you know how to jump bodies, basically, and take over someone else's body. So you know, like a vampire, too. You know, you can live for so long in one body, but once it starts to deteriorate, you need to get a new one. And, you know, in the horror stories, like one is called Mephisto Waltz. It's a movie. And so we can watch it. It's all about this topic. The guy has he's a warlock, and also he's fond of playing the piano. He's very good at playing piano. So he's about to die, and he wants to shed that body and get a new one, which requires, you know, essentially murdering the person that is in that body that you want to get. And so he's shopping around for someone who has the perfect hands to play piano, so he can keep playing piano. I take this stuff kind of seriously.
Yeah.
I think that this is obviously something the elite of the world are very interested in, being able to live as long as possible. Of course, you know, like anybody, you would want to stay, you know, in the body you're in as long as you can comfortably. But when that gets to be too uncomfortable, the elite of the world are looking for any way they can to keep going. And, you know, a lot of them are interested in the occult. A lot of them are involved in secret societies. I wouldn't doubt if some of them at least have tried, you know, think they know how to jump bodies.
Yeah.
And frankly, I wouldn't doubt if someone actually does know how to do it. And maybe someone like David Bowie.
Yeah. You know, I love that alchemical esoteric view of it, which also then ties to what's going on with technology and, you know, the secret cloning kinds of technology, things that are really going on. You know, they're kind of, it seems to me like they're creating a technological process to try and do things that not maybe they either haven't been able to accomplish through the alchemical process or hasn't worked the way they've wanted to. So either I noticed that, you noticed that there's always trying to achieve some technological version of an esoteric process that has, you know, been done throughout time.
Yes. Well, okay. AI, is really trying to create the perfect golem, I think.
Yeah.
Which is an artificial person. Another term for it is homunculus.
So
the idea you can create a robot. In fact, that word also robot is connected to the same history, the same idea. Creating the first robots were actually just sort of mechanical. Robots, obviously they weren't computerized, but they were mechanical things made of metal that, you know, gave off the illusion almost, at least to people at that time, of being alive.
Yeah.
But there was a magical connection there where sorcerers claimed that they could animate these things and put spirits into them. So this is, I think, of course, it's all part of the quest to live forever.
Yeah.
So if you can't live in a living body, well, at least, you know, maybe a robot or something.
Yeah.
And then, like I said, you know, the ideal is to just stay in the body you're in as long as you can. Because I don't think also that it's necessarily comfortable to change from one body to another.
Yeah.
I think it's a very traumatic process for everyone involved. So, you know, they want to stay with the bodies they have as long as possible. I don't know if you saw this headline. A couple days ago, Peter Thiel, the guy who founded PayPal, wants to go around harvesting blood from young people and selling it to old people so they can have transfusions and, you know, it will enliven them and make them feel better and help them live longer.
So I saw there was a headline about something like that. I never got a chance to watch the video or read the article, but so that's interesting. That and it's gross.
Well, I mean, this is again, you know, this is sort of a ancient, you know, occult idea that, as it turns out, is, you know, perfectly valid scientifically, that you can get vigor from the youth by literally taking it from their blood.
Well, isn't that also why like some elite groups and secret societies have cannibalism and eating, they sacrifice some children and eating them and things like that? Isn't it a similar kind of thing? You know, there being the fetuses of babies and Pepsi products, like it's the same thing, right?
Yeah, that's the theory. And I mean, once you know, look at, you know, the headlines, you see these things pop up every now and then. Once you're aware of it, you see it everywhere and you realize, oh, it's not a joke. It's serious. They are doing this.
Yeah.
And it goes back to what we're talking about Saturn eating his children,
Right.
Gaining something by taking it away from the youth. They do this in numerous ways. And it's interesting. I mean, that's just the way this world we're in works, I think, that a principle that is valid in one context will often be valid in other contexts as well. So we're talking about economic eating of the future or literally eating children. It's all the same. It all is connected to the same principle.
Absolutely. Okay. So I think this is a good time for us to take a break, and we're going to go on intermission. We have a track called Saturn by the artist Simic. We'll be back in just a minute. Before we move on, I just wanted to give you a chance to tell people about your website and where they can find your work.
Sure. My website is tracytwyman.com, which if you're watching this, you probably know how to spell, but it's T-R-A-C-Y-T-W-Y-M-A-N.com. And, you know, if you Google that, you'll easily find it. And then all of my books are on Amazon. So I've got about, I think, five print books so far and several Kindle books also. So, you know, that's how you find me. That's where my stuff is.
All right, cool. So we're going to get into talking about some other topics that Tracy's been covering lately. And she had an interesting post about Trump and Clinton possibly both being rapists. So why don't you get into what you've been talking about, Tracy?
Sure. Okay. Just just to start off, because of course it's necessary because people are so, you know, trigger happy, like they get triggered by everything. I'm an anarchist. I do not vote. So I do not care.
Me too.
I care, but you know, I'm not going to participate. I have no, you know, what do they call it? I don't have a horse in this race.
Dog in the fight. Yeah, me either. I'm an anarchist too. So you're in good company.
But I mean, I've had, I guess, an axe to grind against the Clintons for a long time. I hate them. I hate them a lot. I grew up in that era. You know, and I became a journalist right during the time when a lot of the Clinton dirty laundry was really just starting to come to light, I think. Of course, we all knew, I mean, even during the his first campaign, we knew about Jennifer Flowers, and we kind of got a hint that, oh, he's, you know, he likes the ladies, he likes to cheat on his wife. But only, you know, it took a few years before the real dirt started coming out, and it was coming out basically on talk radio at that time. So we're talking about mid-90s, and I was, again, you know, 18 years old, I think. This is what I did. I voted twice in my life, and that was the first time I voted in that election. At any rate, I remember writing several articles for, I told you about that newspaper I worked for when I was a teenager. I remember writing some stuff about Clinton. Just starting to realize, you know, that he had been involved with all of this cocaine trafficking for the CIA when he was governor. And so I interviewed, at that time, I interviewed Larry Nichols, who was one of the whistleblowers. He had put out the Clinton Chronicles back then. It was like a videotape that was being passed around. It was a documentary about Bill Clinton and all of his crimes. And that included the stuff about killing people that were witnesses to the cocaine trafficking, and beating up and threatening people that he had been sexually involved with that he wanted to keep quiet, or people who had witnessed that. So, you know, that's what I knew about Clinton, you know, back in the day. And I just couldn't believe when this whole, I mean, Hillary Clinton has been acting ever since they got out of office, like she's just totally entitled to be president.
Right.
I don't understand why people, but people go along with it. Like they, like that makes sense to them. And she, I guess, has had the attitude that nothing's going to stand in her way. I mean, she's even kind of, obviously she knows she's going to be president someday, or that's not what she's planning. And yet she commits all of these crimes in broad daylight.
It's so crazy.
This is the way the Clintons are. Okay.
Yeah.
They expect every person they deal with to fall on their sword for them at any moment. Anytime there's any problem, they never take responsibility for it. And not only that, they assume that everyone around them is going to sacrifice themselves in order to cover up and, you know, make everything good. Yeah. And strangely, that's what seems to happen. So recently I interviewed this guy, his name is Robert Morrow, and he wrote a book with Roger Stone, who was one of the main, main campaign advisors for Trump.
He's on Alex Jones every week talking about why about Donald Trump. So yes, he's very, very much involved in that.
Right. So yes. And so they wrote this book, I guess, you know, before the Trump campaign really got off the, well, I don't know. I'm trying to remember, but what's key to know is the book. Yeah. The book came out before certain allegations about Donald Trump came out. So when these allegations came out, the allegations were that Donald Trump raped a 13-year-old girl at Jeffrey Epstein's house, or not on the airplane, I think at one of his houses.
On the little Virgin Islands or whatever, right? Isn't that what they're called?
And so, you know, there's an affidavit, I think, about this, or you know, this girl has made some kind of statement in court, and there's a witness who also corroborates her story and has made a statement in court. So, you know, that's interesting. And it is, what's really interesting is, of course, Bill Clinton is also tied to Jeffrey Epstein, and actually went, you know, on airplane rides on his notorious private plane that was supposedly full of underage girls that everyone was having sex with. So anyway, so I interviewed this guy. And he, Robert Morrow, co-author with Roger Stone on this book called The Clinton's War on Women.
Right.
About all about Bill Clinton, you know, raping women, and then Bill and Hillary trying to cover it up.
Yeah.
So, but it turns out that Robert Murrow believes the stories about Donald Trump. He believes that Donald Trump is a rapist also. So, yeah. So you can see this interview if you want to. You can go to my YouTube channel and you'll see this. It's about an hour long, and it's a video interview like we're doing here. The guy has a mouth on him. He swears a lot, and he also says, you know, terms that are no longer acceptable about homosexuals.
Yeah.
So
I'm familiar with Robert Morrow. I've heard him before. Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, it's like that's my warning to you, I guess. If that bothers you, well, either deal with it or don't watch it now.
Yeah.
But anyway, I think, you know, truth trumps everything. I wanted to hear what he had to say no matter what. So I think that he's got a very interesting story. He'll tell you all about, you know, the crimes that Bill Clinton has been involved in. And he also has a lot to say about Donald Trump and why he thinks that this allegation is true. And then that, you know, obviously that just really calls into question the integrity of this election. Because, I mean, we know that Donald Trump and Hillary and Bill, they all know each other. They've been photographed together. You know, they even talked together shortly before he announced his campaign run. So, you know, I guess a lot of people are wondering
what the hell is really going on here?
Is Donald Trump basically a foil for to get in office? And I don't know, but I mean, it's really a question of how much money does Donald Trump actually have? Is he lying about how much money he has? Because that's key to whether or not he's being pushed around by anyone or whether he's trying to help anyone. I would think that if he has enough money, he would not be motivated to do anything for anyone else, including the Clintons. And, you know, if his motivations would be exactly what they seem to be then, that, you know, he wants to be president and he's going to do his best to get there, and he's going to use his money and everything else. But you got to kind of wonder, you know, it's like Robert Murrow, I asked him, you know, why do you have to say, you know, all these offensive words? How does that help you get your message across? Same thing about with Donald Trump. I mean, why? Yeah. You know, does he have to be so, belligerent and offensive?
Yeah.
I don't know. And it calls into question, what is his real motive for doing this? So, because I live here, you know, I hope Donald Trump is for real. I hope the rape allegation isn't true. I don't know. But, you know, it doesn't look good. So
it is so weird. Like, absolutely. I mean, his behavior often makes it look like he's working for Hillary, because he's just acting so stupid that any person who has one bit of sanity might think that Hillary Clinton is a better option. She's not. Like, this to me, we're in this situation where, like, I don't understand how anybody can take not only our political system but the concept of government seriously anymore at all, when these are the choice. If this is supposedly a legitimate system, how is this in any way rational, reasonable, moral, or at all? Period. You know, so for me, like you, I don't have a dog in the fight. Like, I don't, you know, I recognized, you know, some time ago that, you know, at first I recognized just how ridiculous and criminal government was. And then I recognized that it was, you know, very much like religion. And if people would stop believing in it, maybe it would go away. So hurry up, people. You know what I mean? But it is, you know, I agree with you. I live here. And to me, Clinton seems worse than Trump.
You know what I mean? Yes. I mean, okay. And the fact that he's a rapist is pretty bad, but what we're doing here, there's the concept of the Overton window, right?
Yep. Moving it.
This is, you know, what's considered acceptable in society. Certain amounts of rape, child rape by the elites are considered acceptable now because everybody does it. So, all the elite, normal people do not do this, but people that are in positions of power for some reason are all having sex with children. I don't know why.
I mean, actually, you know, what's really scary is it's coming out more and more that there's a lot of even normal people who are doing this. Like, it's, you know, it's weird. Just last night, so I was a gymnast, and just this last 24 hours, there's come out this huge story about all these coaches that the USA Gymnastics Federation basically hid the files on, who have now been convicted of molesting and abusing children and whatnot. And some of that hits home for me because it's something that I had suspected and thought that I had seen some of and whatnot. But it's everywhere. Like, everywhere I turn now, people are coming out about having been molested as a child, or having, you know, are people that you would never have suspected have now been caught doing it. And we are living in a profoundly sick society. And I think the fact that these are our choices is so perfectly represents that. But the reason I think Donald Trump is better is A, the Overton window that you were speaking of. But also, I think, you know, during this last 8 years with Obama, a lot of people who are to the more conservative side have woken up to the truth about a lot of things. And I think having Donald Trump as president would force the liberals to get their heads out of their asses. And you know, I think a lot of things that I've been saying about government that I come from a family of liberal people, so they think I'm crazy when I'm saying these things. But if Donald Trump is president, I bet you suddenly they'll agree with all the things that I've been saying about government. So to me, I just think that, like, you know, we have this choice that is really a choice between fascism and fascism. You know what I mean? But one is, like, you know, one is provenly super duper violently corrupt and criminal, and the other is just lacking in integrity, morals, and taste to a certain extent, and maybe a criminal as well. But the whole thing, the fact that, I mean, you know, people, if you insist on voting, voting is consenting to the system, and so I don't consent and I don't vote, even, you know, I'm an whatever. But Joe Stein or Gary Johnson or someone is better than these two. But since this is what we're dealing with, I don't know. It's awful to think. And I thought it was really, I didn't know. I've heard Robert Morrow several times on other programs, and I knew he had written that book. I wasn't aware that he had this view of Donald Trump as well. So it was really interesting to see that. And I think you're the only one who's really done an interview with him about that.
I am, I think. And, you know, well, I tried to circulate it. Facebook was killing the link. They wouldn't, you know, it's up there, but they're not propagating.
We'll link to it.
algorithm is trying to hide it. And in fact, I've experienced a lot of that with Hillary stuff lately.
Yeah.
Like that, you saw this news story about, there's this mural in Melbourne, Australia. It shows Hillary in this bathing suit. It's got American stripes and stars on it. And then there's money in her waistband, tucked in her waistband. So this is a mural on the side of a building. This artist is known for doing graffiti art.
Yeah.
And then the building owner consented to have this thing there. Well, the city council of Melbourne, or whatever little township near Melbourne he's in, had basically forced this business owner to have the guy cover it up. He ended up putting a niqab on Hillary to cover up her flesh. Sure. Because they said the city council's objection was that it was inappropriate to show a woman like that. So, you know, that's weird. And it seemed odd. It almost seemed like, you know, Hillary Clinton's people called up the city council in Australia, in this town in Australia, which is why, you know?
I've heard more extreme stories with the Clintons of, like, hiring trolls to do stuff than of any other single politician or corporation or any. It's like, they're like Monsanto. Like, Monsanto will hire, for every one person who says something negative about Monsanto, they'll hire somebody to, like, troll shit out of them for the rest of their living days, you know?
Yes.
Clinton seemed to be like that, both on a very advanced scale, like killing people who witness things and won't go along, but also on this, anytime someone says anything bad, can press on somebody to delete, to make the algorithm not show their video or cover up what that, it is crazy. It is crazy how deep it goes, and, like, why do they even care about what's being said about them at a low level if they're really so powerful? It's very strange. It's very disturbing.
Well, but okay, Hillary recently said, I think it was her or some campaign organ, someone from her campaign, said that they were relying on satire to bring down Donald Trump. So they're, and it's, you know, because they're not going to bring up rape allegations about Jeffrey Epstein, and there really isn't a lot else to say about Donald Trump.
Yeah, they really wanted to squash him. If they really wanted to squash him and he wasn't working for them, they would bring up the rape allegations.
Yes, but... You know, obviously,
that indicts Bill too. Then, and, you know, so
she can't even. You know, she said something about rape victims when she was at her speech at the convention, and of course, everyone, you know, sees them, like, lady, you can't talk about rape. Look at you. Look at what your husband did. Look what you did to the rape victims. And so, I mean, there's so many of these topics that she can't be taken seriously on now because of, you know, her past. I mean, just the fact that she, you know,
what
she and her husband both have lied.
Seriously.
Exactly. That's a good point. I mean, She had the director of the FBI come out a couple of weeks ago and say she's too incompetent mentally to know what a classified document is.
Right.
Or to understand how to run email or anything. So,
I mean, if you or I were caught with, even just if we, like, we're in danger if we download a classified document from WikiLeaks, of possibly some, you know, reporters can be in trouble for things like that. So this whole thing, this whole other, like, level of things that are acceptable for the Clintons as opposed to anyone else in the world. I mean, how is Bradley Manning in jail and Julian Assange stuck in an embassy? Whether you think that he's for real or not is not the issue. That's what we're looking at in the world. And she can do this and it's just, it's okay. Oh, it was just negligence. Well, why isn't it just negligence for them too?
Well, it was odd, the press conference that Comey had. You know, I watched the whole thing live. I'm sitting there. He kept building the case against her. And I'm thinking, wow, you know, it's finally going to happen. Someone's finally going to get her. And then he makes this bizarre statement at the end. But no reasonable prosecutor would bring this case against her. And then he even said before that, well, you know, other people who did this wouldn't get away with it. He essentially said that. So, but he didn't come out and say, why is this person immune? Yeah. And really, why is she immune? Okay, she's the wife of a former president. It's not going to bring down, you know, society for her to face a little bit of justice. But I guess they consider the whole left-right paradigm, the two parties, that whole thing is just so precious and important to them.
It's kind of like when they said, we can't bring down the banks because they're too big to fail.
Yes.
It's like the whole world will fall apart if we bust the people who are actually committing the crimes. So we just have to bust the people who are the minions a little bit here and there. And the people who aren't committing crimes except for anyone against themselves, we'll throw them in jail for the rest of their lives. You know what I mean?
I had been hopeful for a while. I saw this thing developing. I thought, hey, this election is going to destroy that whole system. The Republican Party is falling apart, and look, if you know, what if
I look at the Democratic Party, that the way they censored the coverage of the Democratic National Convention was crazy.
Yes, and we all know, you know, they rigged it against Bernie. And not only that, you know, I was thinking, well, heck, you know, Hillary could do two things. She could die or she could get arrested before the election, and then what would they do, you know? And one way or another, that's going to end up, if that were to happen, it would destroy the party, I think, because they've put all their eggs in this basket.
The party really needs to be destroyed. Yeah, the party needs to be destroyed. That whole nonsense with Debbie Wasserman Schultz, who being like having to step down because she rigged it for Hillary, but then going to work for Hillary. Like, that's another one of these things where they're not ashamed to admit, yep, we did it. And we're going to, you know, rub your faces in it. You know, it's like, it's crazy.
I wonder what she's thinking. I mean, did she realize this before? And how does she feel about it now to know every single email she's ever sent is public now? I think probably, you know, at least in the last 10 years, every email, or, you know, the last few years. I mean, hey, who knows where that ends too, because obviously there's been no attempt at security surrounding these people. You know, and again, I think it comes from the arrogance, right? They assume everyone around them is going to cover for them. So they don't even have to put a firewall around their, or whatever they call it. Yeah. You know, they don't even have to protect their
email. They have to encrypt their emails. They're like, you know, it's crazy. Did you see that video of her that came out last week where she was like having some like weird, like convulsion, almost like, you know, her programming malfunctioned or something like that. And it looked like she was like possessed by the devil for a minute. Her head was like, she looked like she liked it though, man. Did you see that?
I did, and I think Paul Joseph Watson put out a good video a couple days ago where he theorized that, you know, what was it, some stroke she had a few years ago? There was some kind of a medical incident she had. She was in the hospital for a while.
She, like, fell. Yeah, she hit her head and had some kind of thing, yeah.
So he explained it that everything that she's been doing that's weird since then in public is an example of that, is a typical side effect, after effect of having such an experience. So the convulsions, and there's a couple of videos of her doing, you know, what looks like epilepsy, having a fit. And then there's also maniacal laughter that goes on for a long time and seems inappropriate. She does that a lot, but more so in the last few years than ever. So, I mean, she was always a hothead. She's always been, you know, verbally and physically abusive to her husband and everyone else around her.
Yeah.
So she's already mentally unstable, but it's possible that this other, this medical stuff happened, that, you know, if she's completely lost her mind. And we know that Huma said in one of these emails, she often gets confused. I'll have to remind her about her appointment in the morning because, you know, she forgets.
That maniacal sort of demonic laughter, I first noticed when she laughed about having killed Gaddafi. He came, he died. It seemed to start from then. And then the hitting the head incident after it was, you know, like, That something changed. I mean, it's always been evil and bad and whatever, but something changed to like almost what seems like outright demonic possession and just like behavior like that is just almost absolutely unhuman at about that point in 2012, 11, 12, 13, something like that. I don't know. Okay. So So it's fascinating. And, we are in so much trouble. We're in
you
trouble.
And me personally, or the country, the world.
The country. Not we personally. You know, maybe we're in trouble too, but it's all right.
Well, I was nervous when I put the Robert Murrow interview out. I made several backups of it and I sent it to friends to make sure that if something happened to me, this would come out. You know, because I mean, it's not like I'm breaking a story. Yeah, it was all available information, but like you've described, they feel the need to aggressively persecute anyone who tells the truth about them, even if it's a known truth.
The reason it might be more dangerous for you is because you're the only person I saw cover that topic, but you're also not a quote unquote right wing nut. Although I'm sure people will say that you are. You're clearly not. You know what I mean? Like you don't talk a lot about politics. You know what I mean?
Right.
That's not your main. And you're not pushing Trump. You're not pushing. You know, you don't. That's not something people think of when they think of you. Oh, yeah, she's a right winger. You know what I mean? So it's more dangerous when information comes out from somebody who has a more, you know, just historical, you're looking at things through like, you know, trying to keep track of what's going on in history here. Screwing with the Clintons is dangerous, even no matter what level you're at, it really is. So,
you know, I thought that, what's her name on the airplane? What's the lady's name?
Loretta Lynch. Let's talk about
Loretta Lynch. Okay.
Yeah. Let's talk about that. I like your little blip about that too. And your conversation with your father. I love that. Yeah.
Yeah. My dad, you know, he's sort of has this insight that kind of cuts through the crap sometimes, but it sees things in a clearer way than other people. And so I was talking to him about the weird meeting on the airplane.
Yeah.
I was talking to him about this before Comey came out with his statement. So we still didn't know how this was going to end, but obviously they had this meeting.
Yeah.
And she came out and said they talked about grandchildren. And, you know, so everyone's theorizing, well, actually what happened is Bill got on the plane and bribed her and or threatened her, you know, to let Hillary off. Well, my dad immediately thought, well, that's not even necessary. He came on the plane, you know, out of nowhere, and she wouldn't have expected that. All of a sudden, former president shows up on her airplane on the tarmac. I mean, who does that? That's weird. So already you're kind of off put, like, you know, you're like relaxing and all of a sudden the president's there and you can't really say no, or the former president. And she probably felt like she couldn't say no, even though she should have. But, you know, she was taken by surprise. And then he's standing there in front of her saying, you know, hey, I love my grandchildren so much. They're great. But, you know, what about yours? I don't know what he said, but
totally implied threat. Yeah.
But here's the thing. Bill and Hillary have hired people in the past to threaten people that for one reason or another are threatening to them, such as the example I gave in the article that on my website is Kathleen Willey.
Yeah.
Who was groped by Bill Clinton in the Oval Office. And, she didn't even try to do anything about it, but she ended, I guess she told a few people and word got around. And so
her cat and stuff like that. Yeah.
So what happened is, she was going to get, deposed for the Paula Jones case.
Yeah.
And, so you know, they could find out what happened to her and make a case that this is the kind of guy he is. Well, so Bill Clinton hired some thug to come threaten her. And, she had her cat disappear. Her tires got slashed, a bunch of other stuff that already happened, and she was already kind of suspicious about that. And then some guy pretending to be a jogger shows up at her house and says, you know, starts talking about, how's your cat? That was a great, he was a good old cat, wasn't he? Did you ever get your tires fixed? And then he talks about her kids. Then he talks about her neighbor and her neighbor's kids, mentions them all by name. And then at the end of it, he says, you're just not getting the message, are you? Okay, so she knew that was a threat against her and her children.
Yeah.
He was taking credit saying he had already killed her cat. This is the kind of people the Clintons are, and they have a reputation. Everyone in D.C. knows this about them, okay?
Yeah.
So when Bill Clinton shows up on your airplane and starts talking about grandkids out of the blue, and you know you've got a case, you know, pending with his wife, it's obvious what he's there for. And the threat is implied. He does not have to say it.
Yeah,
so,
no.
So,
it's very possible it just went exactly how he said. We talked about grandchildren, and that's it.
Well, cause that's what she said. She told Congress that there was a witness there. There was her husband was there, and flight attendants were there. So she's probably telling the truth.
Yeah.
But she's not telling the truth about how she took it or the reason why she let Hillary off. And we don't know what they did to Comey, but they probably did something to him, too.
Yeah, because, he seemed to have been fairly respected and thought fairly highly of in terms of his having good integrity and stuff before that. And then he just blew his entire history of having good integrity out the water with what he did.
But notice he spent all that time at the press conference making the case.
Yes, making the case.
And then saying that anyone else would be prosecuted. So it was almost like he was laying it out there for the next person. Because I predict, of course, he's going to resign shortly. You know, he's giving it a little time so that it won't look too suspicious, but pretty soon he's going to decide that he needs to spend more time with his family.
Yeah.
And someone else will take over. And it'd be interesting. I mean, here's the thing. If Donald Trump was really independent, then Hillary should be afraid that if he gets to be president, he's going to do something to bring justice to her.
Yeah.
She's not really acting like she's afraid.
She's never acted like she's afraid.
True. I don't know. I don't know what it means, but
Yeah, I saw her on Charlie Rose a few weeks ago, right after Comey had you know, said they weren't going to prosecute her. And Charlie Rose is left-leaning and generally someone I would consider to be in support of her. But he I was actually impressed that he was trying to pick at her a little bit. I mean, softball way, but more than I expected. And she just, she wouldn't give an inch. Like, she never does anything wrong. She, you know, he was trying to even get her to admit that it was in like bad judgment or bad whatever. And she won't even do that. You should have watched the way she was trying to use words to control him. And this is one person, Charlie Rose is a master at using words to control the people he interviews. And so you're watching this, like, it was like hard to watch. It was almost like watching somebody have like a seizure or Tourette syndrome, watching the back and forth here. But it was like a battle of semantics. You know
do you remember? Do you remember when she first started making her, you know, self-defense statements about the email? She said something like, "There is no classified information."
Right.
There is no classified information. She's doing the exact same thing her husband did about the meaning of the word "is." I'll bet you.
Yeah.
Fall to the carpet again. She'll bring that out. She'll say, "Oh, well, I was only talking about the present tense." I mean, and then she'll just wait for the person to, you know, push her in a corner again. That's what they do. It's like gaslighting the entire country. They'll just keep saying something totally preposterous.
Yeah.
Even though nobody believes them, they just stay the course, and somehow they end up never receiving any consequences. Because I don't know if it was in the Charlie Rose thing or what, but in a recent interview she did, she even said that the FBI cleared her, exonerated her, and said that she hadn't made any false statements.
All right, she completely she lied.
She lied about them saying that she didn't lie when they lie that she lied.
She couldn't be satisfied with the fact that she'd gotten away with it. She had to go back and rewrite history in the way that she sees everything, because she can do whatever she wants. And it is funny. Yes, it does depend on what your interpretation or definition of the word is, which I, for some reason, I don't know why. I don't even know why I'm saying this. It's off topic. But I always found it interesting that ISIS is too.
Ah, yes.
I love wordplay, and I learned to pay. I used to just love doing it, but I've learned to pay more attention to it. You know what I mean? And it's one of those things. And I don't know if there, I don't know why I thought that, but that's just the first thing that came to my mind is ISIS is depends on what is too, you know? Right? Okay. So the last thing I wanted to get into, you have an interesting post on your site about that refers back to an interview you did with somebody who named Prince Michael, I think it was his name, right? Who had some ideas about an independent Scottish monarchy. I'm assuming that you wrote, you brought that back up because of what was going on with Brexit and the things being said about Scotland. Tell us a little bit about that, why you wrote about that, and then I have something interesting I wanted to add to that.
Okay. Prince Michael, I interviewed him 1998, I think, for Dagobert's Revenge. As a guy claiming to be the rightful heir to the throne of Scotland. He says that he's from this, quote, royal house of Stuart, and they spell their name a little bit differently than the Stuart royal family, but they claim that they're the same. You know, it's just a different way of spelling it. But, you know, he ended up getting, torn apart by the press a few years later. They, you know, someone actually investigated his claims. He ended up running back. He's from Belgium, and right. He came to Scotland to try to become king. He's lived there for years, building up his reputation, but he ended up just getting destroyed by the newspapers because they said that his genealogy was fake and stuff like that. But anyway, at the time I interviewed him about his claims. He wanted to be the king of Scotland, and then and for Scotland to secede from the UK and to join the EU on its own. So at that time I had never heard of that idea, and you know, I was surprised to, I guess I didn't think about it before, but yeah, of course, they could be part of the EU without having to be part of the UK. I thought that was, an interesting idea. Now, Prince Michael ended up, you know, over the course of the next several years, I ended up learning a lot more about him. So he was involved with this group called the Dragon Court at one point, and then he ended up leaving the Dragon Court. But I too was involved with this organization called the Dragon Court, which is, it's a loose conglomeration of people all claiming to be from certain royal families, you know, not the, you know, main scions of these families, but just people who happen to have that blood in them. And the leader of this group at that time was a guy named Nicholas DeVere, who I became friends with, and he asked me to help him publish a book. If you're viewers are familiar at all with Lawrence Gardner, who wrote a series of books about the Grail and the Grail bloodline and things like that. So Lawrence Gardner and Nicholas DeVere used to be writing partners, and Lawrence Gardner used to be part of the Dragon Court. And Lawrence Gardner said that most of his material for his first few books on those subjects came from Nicholas DeVere. In fact, they wrote, basically Lawrence Gardner's first book was Nicholas DeVere's book, and he sort of stole it from him. They ended up having a falling out because of this. I'm telling you all this because Prince Michael was part of the Dragon Court, and his whole, the titles that he uses, like he claims to be the real leader of the Knights Templar in modern times and things like that. He's falling back on the stuff, these titles that were given to him by the Dragon Court.
Right.
But he left the Dragon Court, but he still uses the titles. It's really bizarre. I ended up looking into this whole subject. In fact, I was, at one point, because I was friends with Nick, Nick DeVere, for a while, I was actually the head of the Dragon Court. He called himself the sovereign, and he was over me, but he basically wanted me to sort of deal with the public for him because he didn't want to have to deal with the public. So he made me the leader, and then I tried to sort of administrate and do PR for them for a while, but it ended up falling apart. I mean, I don't even know my genealogy.
I was going to say, do you have connections to royal bloodlines?
I don't know. He kept thinking that I was, like, he thought because of the way I looked and my interests that I must be part of the bloodline. But so he would, Nicholas DeVere would repeatedly ask me to send him a vial of my blood that a doctor would take. And then he would have it, tested to see if I was part of the dragon line, bloodline as they call it. So back to the Prince Michael guy. I had, of course, some inside knowledge about this stuff because of my friends in the Dragon Court, but also I did a little bit of research on my own. He's a very interesting character, and so the people around him are very interesting. By researching him, I found out about there's this whole nexus between fake royal families and real royal families. Mm-hmm. A lot of these people know each other and hang out together. And by fake, I mean just there are all of these groups. Dragon Court is one of them, but there's several that you know, they claim to be about a royal family that when you look at it, when you look at these people, there's not a lot of evidence to back up their claims of their genealogy, and the people that gave them their titles or the organizations that gave them their titles are not considered historic and accredited. Right. So there's all these sort of fake royals running around selling titles to each other and to other people. Right. And then there's the real ones. But what's weird is the real ones and the fake ones know each other a lot of times and are friends. And the other confluence that's part of this nexus is the intelligence community. So a lot of the people that are part of either one of those groups are also part of the intelligence community around the world. Then there's this other aspect to it, well, secret societies, you know, and occultism. So I ended up finding, for instance, there's this group called the IBSSA. It stands for a Slovenian phrase, I think, but when you translate it, it's a security and bodyguard organization.
Right. That's interesting.
When you look at this group, every one of its leaders is part of either a fake royal family or a real royal family. And then they have photographs of all of their events and things that they, you know, parties and things that they do.
Right.
And a lot of the times these guys are wearing regalia of royal families or of the Templar groups that they're all members of. And Prince Michael is part of this thing. So, and here's another thing. Okay. A lot of them have NGOs in the UN. They are involved in the United Nations somehow. So, I don't know. I through studying the subject, and Prince Michael was sort of my gateway drug that got me into it. Yeah. I found a underworld that I didn't even know existed. And I don't think most people do.
Yeah. No. Okay, so that is interesting. I have heard stuff before about the fake royalty and the real royalty working together, being friends, and having some kind of, you know, connection. It seems strange to me, but you'd think they wouldn't like each other, but doesn't seem to be that way. Okay, so I'm going to throw a strange theory at you just because I think it'd be interesting to discuss with you because it's fascinating. So, okay, I'm gonna guess that you don't know too much about sports and that you're not, you watch sports at all?
No.
Okay. So I have some interest in sports. I was a gymnast, and particularly I like tennis. Something, again, about the sacred geometry of space, time, and sound. I don't know, right? Okay, so there's a tennis player. He's number two in the world. His name's Andy Murray. He won Wimbledon this year for the second time. He's also won the U.S. Open once. And I have a really interesting theory about him that I've tossed by a few people, and some of them think that might have something to it. So he, to start at the beginning, he was in the preschool in Dunblane, Scotland, that got shot up, that created all of the gun laws in the UK, basically, that led to disarmament and stuff like that. So that he was in that preschool when he was very young. And when they compete internationally, they're competing for Great Britain, but he is Scottish. And he looks, if you look at him, he has a very interesting background. If you look at him, he looks almost exactly like Prince Charles. It's the same hairline, same face profile, and he looks an awful lot like Prince William.
Okay.
His wife, her name is Kim Sears, looks almost exactly like Prince William's wife. All right? And one of the interesting things about Andy Murray is that you never see his father. You see his mother all the time. She was his coach for a while. She's always around at these things. But when he won the U.S. Open, that was the first major he won. The first thing he did is he went and he bought the hotel in Scotland where the Knights Templar were formed. And then the next year when he won Wimbledon, Queenie was there and he was knighted. And then he just won Wimbledon again this year. And the Prince William was there and his wife was there. Prince William and his wife were there. And obviously Andy Murray's wife is there. And it's weird. They look like they could be like twin couples almost. Right. Hmm. And he even acknowledged in the crowd that David Cameron was there and said, "I don't think I would like to be prime minister." Okay. I have this theory and I can't explain why, but it's just, it's one of those things that from observing things, I don't know. I use, one of my interests in sports is to sort of use it as a way of a symbology kind of thing about what's going on geopolitically and in the rest of the world.
Okay.
So he's been knighted and he is he looks to me like he's related to royalty. Like he could be the illegitimate son of Prince Charles.
Yeah.
I have this, the feeling inside of me that he, if Scotland ever broke off from England, that he would be a king, a possibility as a king of Scotland, independent monarchy. I mean, I should have thought about it to bring up a picture. If you look at this guy from the side, the hairline, and he's a great tennis player, and he seems to be a reasonably decent person. But it is an odd thing for someone who's just an athlete, okay, to the first thing they do when they win the U.S. Open is to go by the hotel where the Knights Templar was formed. Right?
Yes.
Okay. And when he got married, like, he got married about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, he got married in like the full like Scottish regalia Templar kind of outfit, you know, like stuff. It is very strange. It's weird. Yeah. But what I find with, particularly with tennis, and I've gotten into looking at things. I look at a lot of different things in sports. I mean, I was a gymnast, so with gymnastics, I look at it mostly in terms of possibilities of genetic alteration and transhumanism kind of things going on there to be unable. I mean, if you look at the gymnasts, and this is not me saying bad things about these athletes. I appreciate them and respect them. But the gymnast who's the number one in the world right now, you'll all see her in the Olympics in a few weeks. Her name's Simone Biles. It is almost unhuman how much better she is than everybody else. It doesn't seem, everyone else, even though they're way better than me, I can feel in my body how they're doing what they're doing. I have no way of relating to what's going on, how she's doing gymnastics.
Does she look masculine at all?
Yeah, I mean, she's very small, so she doesn't look masculine in the same way that Serena Williams does.
So she couldn't be a transsexual.
Well, I think, okay, well, let's just get off topic here and go to something else. I think I'm of this.
I didn't mean to change the subject.
No, let's go there. It's a great question. I'm of the opinion, I've spent enough time in high level athletics and then enough time researching things, MK Ultra and things like this. I think there is some kind of intersex athletic program, sort of experimentation kind of thing going on. And I think that it's, you know, Bruce Jenner is evidence of that. I think Serena Williams is evidence of that. And I never really thought about it with Simone Biles. She's so small. It's hard to think of it that way. She's 4'8". She's 19 years old and she's 4'8". You know what I mean? She's very tiny. But yeah, when she does gymnastics, it looks more like what it looks like when the men do gymnastics. You know what I mean? She like has an incredible amount of very easy power. So anyway, that's why I don't know. They're getting a little off topic there, but it's something that as I've looked at the things that have gone on with Bruce Jenner, some things with Serena Williams, and just some other athletes, there is something going on that is odd. I think there's odd things going on everywhere. But so I look at gymnastics that way through conspiratorial eyes. I look at baseball and basketball and some of this stuff a lot through similar eyes as the researcher Zachary Hubbard and his research on gematria, and gematria being a language of coding numbers into words and what is really being mirrored, paralleled, shown in a lot of these sporting stories and sporting events. But then with tennis, I look at it, if you look into the background, a lot of these top players, they have very interesting connections. A lot of them seem to be related in some way to royalty. They seem to have, they seem to be like icons or embodiments of certain principles that I find to be interesting. Like, you know, one of the top players in the world for many years now, his name is Roger Federer. Maybe you've heard of him. And he's from Switzerland, which isn't known as a sports powerhouse, right? But he is in the Rolex. He's in all the Rolex commercials. And the Rolex commercials he's in talk about not just recording history, but creating it. And, you know, he's sort of a timeless kind of player. He's been around for a long time. And he really takes time away from his opponents. He's from Switzerland. Switzerland is also where CERN is, the Large Hadron Collider, right? They're finding the God particle, but what they're really doing, I think, is sort of trying to rip holes in the fabric of space and time. Okay.
Right.
So he is from there. And one could say that in tennis, he's a controller of time. You know what I mean? If we look at the United States as being the controller of the military, England as being the controller of the monetary system, London, right, or whatever, and Switzerland would definitely be the controller of time. They have CERN going on there. They're famous for creating watches, which is keep us in this prison of linear time, right? And he seems very, as a representation of that. And then there's another, there's two other tennis players from Switzerland that both of their names reference in my head, because again, I told you I like wordplay. So this could be nonsense, but it's fun, you know, that, so this guy, Stan Wawrinka, Wawrinka, W-A-W-R-I-N-K-A. And he has come along and interrupted the party that some of these big tennis players have had by winning some majors. And to me, in my head, that's, he's the wrinkle in time. And then there's a girl who came out of Switzerland who was just came out of nowhere last year. Her name is Tamea Baczynski, putting time back into something. So you have someone controlling time, someone wrinkling time, someone putting time back in. This could be nonsense, but these are the things my mind goes to. You have Andy Murray, who has this sort of interesting background, and I've drawn some of these connections. And just the way tennis is, like, to me, it's like the age-old battle of, like, wills. And I had this suspicion for some reason. I don't know why. I never played tennis. I'm not good at it. I just love watching it. But it has a very historical feel. And I had this sense that tennis is actually something maybe in, you know, back when it was first when created, or even now, has some way of influencing decisions that are being made. And I was able to do some research and found something called the Tennis Court Oath. And it was like a pact that was made in a rebellion against some kind of king, monarchy, or whatnot, about how it was made on the tennis court. I don't know if it was made through a match or it was just made because they were gathering there. But something changed significantly in that monarchy after that happened. I couldn't find a lot of information about it. There's very few references to it. But this is just some of the nonsense that I like to indulge, that I find, that I draw lines to. But the thing with Andy Murray is pretty interesting. If you get a chance sometime, just go look at it. And I was talking about it with somebody on the same day that I saw your blog about Prince Michael. So okay. not having a reference, maybe it's not that interesting to you, but I just find it, I don't know, I find it fascinating. The other thing I've tracked is, you know, there's obviously like a lot of interesting cultural symbolism going on through people like Serena Williams. I don't know, you don't follow it.
Sorry. Yeah. I know who she is. I know she's a tennis.
Yeah. So yeah, this is out of your wheel, but I guess maybe like in a similar way, it's different, but just how all these things going on, you can draw back on these esoteric things. I see symbolism in pop culture and in sports of the things that are going on, like the micro of the macro or whatever. And I just,
okay. If we're going to take anything seriously that Prince said about the test,
yeah,
that they're running the entertainment industry because mm-hmm. that somehow is integral to the tests that they're doing.
Yeah.
Well, sports is probably part of that too. So
yeah,
maybe these people are, you know, have the settlers too.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
They have to, you know, win a certain number of games or else, I mean, I don't know. I know that, actually this ties in. Okay. I saw something about how the Saudis had been involved in the soccer rigging scandal.
Yes.
Did you hear about that? I know you heard about the soccer scandal, but did you hear about the Saudi aspect of it?
No. So tell me a little bit about that.
I mean, that's all I know is that, I mean, I just remember seeing it and I didn't get a chance to like really dig into it, but, it just made me think, wow, these guys are involved in everything. You know, maybe Prince is right.
Well, this year there was a tennis rigging scandal too. There was a tennis rigging scandal. There's been before, but this a bigger deal was made out of it this year. There's also a big doping scandal going on in tennis with Maria Sharapova having, you know, she's suspended right now. But yeah, okay, so that is interesting. So the soccer thing, I'm not a fan of soccer. Where I work in a Peruvian restaurant, so there are people there are really into soccer. And there's a lot of these scandals with FIFA and whatnot. And it seems to me, I'm sure I know all sports are rigged, but like they don't have quite the level of control over soccer that they have over football, baseball, basketball, and probably tennis. And it seems to me that like a lot of these scandals that are going on are almost to try and force a takeover where they'd be able to sort of control, you know, if you look at, I don't know how it goes for soccer, but if you look on the back of tickets for some of these sporting events, it says that it's entertainment. You know what I mean?
Kind of the way wrestling is entertainment?
Absolutely. And so I'm wondering, and just obviously we know about contracts in the entertainment industry, but it is my opinion, I watch some baseball with my father, I watch a lot of tennis, I watch a lot of sports, that there is a lot of fixing going on. It's not ubiquitous. It's not everywhere. But I think it's in certain situations and whatnot. And sometimes it isn't even fixing about who winds as it is about fixing what the numbers will be related to it, because they're sending symbols. Zachary Hubbard's work is amazing on that, with the gematria. But so it's trying to fix certain numbers and an outcome. But I'm wondering if a lot of these athletes in their contract, the reason they all have talent agents and contracts like this, is to basically say, look, you're going to get to do all this stuff. You're going to get all these advantages. Sometimes it's going to go away that doesn't seem right, and you just got to go with that.
I can totally see that. I think you're probably right. This is one of the reasons why I, have never tried to get back into sports. I mean, I was a Royals baseball fan when I was a kid, and then I kind of got out of it. I've been aware that all these sports are rigged for so long.
Yeah.
That I can't take it seriously. But I wonder, how it's almost like you have to, this is the future of sports, because if you think about it, how can you ever have a fair contest in the future? I mean, they're trying to control doping, which is just people trying to improve their performance somehow. A person, as we were mentioning before, the transgender subject, there are people trying to sort of sneak in, to compete with, people of their same gender when they have changed their gender.
Yeah.
There have been cases where, I think there was a case of a woman in a woman's boxing match who almost killed the other woman.
Yeah, yeah.
Had still the residual power in her body of a man. And then there's people in the running sports that I know have actually, they're open about it. And, the challenge is there. Is anyone going to do anything about it? Is anyone going to say this isn't fair? Then, of course, you have all of the transhumanist body modification that's going to be, that is the wave of the future. That's going to be huge. So a fair contest?
Yeah, there's part of me that thinks that there's a level of that already going on. That I think this transgenderism being pushed is being pushed as the first step towards transhumanism to a certain extent. Okay. Also, if you remember in the last Olympics, there was that runner, Oscar Pistorius, who was missing his leg, who was very high ranked and did very well, and then got in trouble and killed his girlfriend or something weird like that. I think some of this, in the last few Olympics, there's been some of this introduction of people who are missing body parts into the Olympics. Mm-hmm. And to me, it almost seems unattainable that they'd be able to reach that level if there wasn't some further level of transhumanism accompanying that. You know what I mean?
Or it could just be, if you've got fake legs, then you're not going to feel the pain in your legs.
Yeah.
So you can endure more because of that. Or maybe they're, stronger than the biological legs. I can see many different ways that this can go. But how far are we off from, being able to have basically motorized legs that will make you run like a cheetah? Not very far, I don't think.
So you see all those horse robots that DARPA works on for soldier battlefield stuff. Yeah, it is kind of some of these athletes do almost look not human. You know what I mean? They do, they have qualities about them that are reminiscent of either being mechanized or of being animal.
Well, you know what? I mean, I can't be shocked by anything anymore. Everything, the things that I learn on a daily basis are so amazing that anything is possible. So if you prove to me sometime in the future that several known athletes are not at all who they say they are, and they've got, fake body parts that are giving them an advantage, or if they're, pretending to be something biologically that they're not, it's not going to surprise me at all. I mean, I've not been one to glom onto these crisis actor stories, saying that everything in the news is fake. But I actually, it's believable. So, just prove it to me and I'll believe it, because that's all it takes. I don't find it that hard.
That, and also that possibility of thing of MK Ultra athletes and Manchurian candidate kind of athletes. I mean, to me, that seems like a perfect, place to practice with that kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
I'll just say this because I know we're about to end, but if you think about what Prince said about the ratings of, he talked about the test. He said that people are beholden to the settlers due to the ratings that they get. Yeah. Well, I had assumed we're talking about terrestrial radio, terrestrial television. What if we're not?
Yeah.
What if we're the show.
And yeah.
It's the ratings that we generate through our behavior that gets us rewarded or punished by the test.
We're always hearing about how everyone else and everything else out there is always looking at us and very interested in what we're doing. And Marilyn Manson told us we're all stars in the dope show. So, right? So Tracy Twyman, I want to thank you for going all over the place in this conversation and engaging me in some fun topics and some nonsense and also some very serious and interesting stuff. And I hope you enjoyed it. And
yeah, I did.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, you're cool.
No, I enjoyed this conversation. It was good.
For sure. And definitely would love to have you back sometime to talk about one of your books or whatnot, when Randy can join us, because I know he'd have some interesting questions for you. And thank you so much for doing this. And,
sure. Thank you.
Yeah, anything else you want to say?
That's it. Buy my books.
All right. All right. On the way out, we're going to listen to the track Prism by the artist Scan X off of Heart House Records. Thank you very much, guys. Have a good one. The truth is out there. It's inside of you. Find it. Take it easy, guys. Thank you.